Good evening and welcome to the September 12th meeting of the Pembroke Board of Selectmen. We will begin as usual with the Pledge of Allegiance, and this evening we will be led by the Cub Scouts of PAC 105. To the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic on which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you, boys. Now we have the Cub Scouts here, and I'm going to hold off reading any announcements until we're done a hearing from the PAC 105 boys.
Good evening to the board and people of Pembroke. Our names are Griffith and Faith, me and
Michael Matheson,
and Jakey Silverman.
And we are Cub Scouts of PAC 105. We are here to ask permission from the town to sell popcorn door to door and at local businesses. We will be selling popcorn from September 17th through November 10th. This is our only fundraiser for the year. We use the money raised for things like day camp, crafts, lessons, and fun camping adventures. Thank you for supporting the Pembroke Cub Scouts.
Thank you, boys, very much for coming. Could you give me the dates of your sale again, please?
September 17th through November 10th.
And you'll be at local businesses? Be all around the town of Pembroke? Is that where you'll be?
Yeah.
Can you tell us something about the popcorn you'll be selling? Do you have different kinds?
We're in the company this year. We have trail mix,
caramel corn,
the caramel corn. There's this box called the Chocolate Treasures, a three-way premium tin, and we have Movie Pack Theater, Super Supreme Kip Caramel Crunch, Way 3 Cheese Tin, Mauve Sea Salt Tin, 14 Extra Pack Butter, Caramel Corn, and Magic Poppy.
JT, you're a regular salesman.
Very good. Well, I heard a couple of kinds there that I'd be interested in. Does the board have any questions for the boys? Well, we'll be looking forward to seeing you out on your quest here for selling popcorn, and I hope you have a record year. Well, I guess I have to. How could I say no?
I was just going to say.
We'll just leave it with you,
and I'll hold on to it.
Okay.
As usual,
thank you,
Sabrina. Just give the money to
Sabrina.
Thank you.
My nephew lives next door. He'll be by to collect.
So we'll.
I move we grant permission to Scout Troop 105 for solicitation.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none, that's unanimous. Thank you, boys. We wish you good luck. Please note that this meeting is being made available to the public through a live video and audio broadcast on Comcast Government Access Channel 15. And is being recorded for broadcast at future dates. Comments made in open session will be recorded. Do we have any announcements by the board? I had one I would like to mention. Sunday, August 28th, I had the honor of presenting at an Eagle Court of Honor for Eric Frisbee, a citation from the Board of Selectmen in honor of his achievement of the Eagle Scout Award. Eric cleared the path, erected stanchion posts around Peter's Well, which is off of Fairwood Drive, and he built an informational kiosk at that site. He is the 47th Eagle Award winner from Troop 105. So it was a lovely ceremony held outdoors at the Herring Run Park. We also have a hazardous waste collection day. It'll be held as usual at the Pembroke Recycling Center, and the date will be Saturday, October 29th, from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. I have a long list of items which will be acceptable at this day, and some that will not be acceptable. And rather than to read them all, I can tell you that this list is available on the town website. So if you're interested in the Hazardous Waste Collection Day, which we have an excellent turnout every year, please go on the website and you will see the items that you can bring and the ones you can't bring. Thank you. At 7:30, it's too early to have our first, second appointment. That would be from Sealand Corporation. So I'll move down to the action items. And the first item is I'll call on Mr. Thorne to talk to us about an insurance rate letter that he'd like to have us vote on.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, there are approximately 10 towns right now that are in the Mayfair Health Group that are at least examining the programs that are being presented by Mayflower for this fiscal year and for next. One town has already voted to leave the Mayflower Health Group, and that's Rockland. The other nine towns that have been in attendance at these meetings are looking at alternatives to the town's health insurance programs. Not to suggest that we're changing anything, but we could change the third-party carrier or administrator that is handling the program. Now, obviously, this will necessitate a meeting with the town's insurance advisory committee, which is made up of representatives from each union in the community. And so while we're gathering information, one of the things that the Massachusetts Interlocal Insurance Agency, or MIA as it's called, requests a vote of the Board of Selectmen in order for them to furnish quotes based on the town's insurance company. So in order for us to just examine what's out there as alternatives to the Mayflower Health Group, I'm requesting that the Board of Selectmen, as other town administrators and managers are doing to their respective boards of selectmen, requesting that the board vote to request quotes from MIA just to examine the alternatives to the town's health insurance program.
This is your support?
Yes, sir.
Mr. Chairman, I would move the town administrator's recommendation.
Second. Motion by Arthur and second by Bill. Does anyone have any questions for Ed? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none, deem it to be unanimous. Thank you, Ed. The next item that we can deal with...
Well, I do have a question for Ed.
Sorry, Arthur.
That's all right. No, I'm late to the dance. When do we have to notify Mayflower?
If we were going to leave by next July 1st, we'd have to notify them by the end of December.
All right, so we've got some time, but we've got to be cognizant of the fact that we want to notify them on time.
Right, exactly. That's not to suggest that we wouldn't do anything right away, but a lot of towns are looking at the possibility of being out in some form or fashion for FY18. So, anyway, we're moving forward on that, and this is a step in getting some information from Maya. Basically, if we went with Maya, we would offer the exact same plans and the exact same premiums, and we would be judged on our performance in claims history as an entity. We wouldn't be lumped in with 37 other towns and fire districts like we are right now with the Mayflower Health Group.
I think that would be a big advantage, Ed. I believe our claim record is may not be the best, but it's not the worst.
That's correct. We're in the middle of the pack.
Yes. Good. Anyone else have any questions? We'll move on. We have a request from John O'Connor. He would like to resign his position from the ZBA. Do I have a motion on that?
I would move we accept the recommendation of John O'Connor from the Zoning Board of Appeals with regret. He was an excellent member.
I have a motion from Arthur, second by, Bill. Seconded by Bill. Do we have any questions or comments from anyone? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none, we accept John's resignation. As Arthur said, with regret, he's had a long service with the Zoning Board of Appeals. The next item is an application from Timothy Brennan to be on the Town Government Study Committee. Do I have a motion on that?
Mr. Chairman, I move approval.
Second.
Motion by Dan to accept, second by Arthur. Any other comments or questions? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none, I deem that.
Can I follow up on that? Quickly?
Yes, Dan, sorry.
Ed, I asked to make sure that an advisory member could be sit on that.
That's correct.
Okay, just wanted to double check.
Yeah, I checked with Joe Bart about that. I guess that you probably didn't have a chance to talk to him. Or did you?
I called him, left a message, okay. Never called back.
Okay. He went through the town bylaws, the section that deals with advisory, and since the Town Government Study Committee doesn't deal with the appropriation of funds, that's the only prohibition for a member of advisory to be on a committee, an appointed or elected position that deals with the disbursement of funds in town. So since that's not the case, he felt that it was okay for Mr. Brennan to serve on the Town Government Study Committee.
Great. Yeah, and that was my understanding, but the question was asked, so I wanted to be served. Right, and one last thing on that note, Lou, the Town Government Study Committee has now filled their full 7 positions with Mr. Brennan's joining us, and they have, for your information, for the public's information, the Town Government Study Committee recently reorganized. So we have a new organization, and it's, do you have who they are?
I know that Scott is your chairman now.
Right.
And I can pick that up to everybody inside.
Okay. Yes.
Well, that's excellent, Dan. I know you've been a little frustrated trying to get the right number of people in on the right days and so forth, so this really sounds good.
And we're meeting again tomorrow night, so
excellent.
The action is hot and heavy now, so the interest is there again.
Excellent. Thank you. The next item that we're to deal with is a date change request for the Bass Fishing Club tournament. And we had approved a date for them, but there's been some issues that have prevented them from keeping that date. So they would like to change the date, a new date, for the Bass Fishing Club's tournament on Oldham Pond to October 16th. Conservation has approved the date change, and they have also listed the usual set of rules that they would require them to follow. So I would look for a vote.
So moved.
So moved by Bill. Is there a second?
I'll second it for discussion.
Thank you, Arthur. Seconded by Arthur for discussion.
Yeah, it's got a rescheduling on one petition is October 16th from 7 a.m. to 3 p.m. And on the other one, it was 6 a.m. as opposed to 7. And I could see where the hour would make a difference on a weekend to people who are sleeping in.
They want to drop in the water at 7, but they'll be doing registration at 6.
Okay, I mean, we haven't had any complaints from them in the past. So. Yeah, I'm satisfied.
Okay, thank you, Arthur. So we have a motion to change the date from Bill and a second from Arthur. All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Hearing none, I rule it unanimous. We're now to the next item on our agenda. Is a discussion on legal expenditures, legal fees. And I will turn that over to you, Arthur.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I brought up the subject of legal fees because we had an incident or incidents regarding the Board of Health and the expenses that are related to having the problems that we've had. And I found out that the town had spent $115,410 last year in legal fees for 638 hours of work, of which $0 were spent on behalf of the Board of Health. They obviously run a tight ship and did not need to involve town council in anything they did last year. As of this year, in the first 2 months, we have spent $5,792.50, and that's only up through the beginning of August. We don't have the month of August in here yet, nor do we have September. Something is radically wrong, and I think we discussed this several months ago, that we had somebody who ran for public office with a personal agenda, and their personal agenda has cost almost $6,000 in legal fees and fees for police details and so forth. I'm going to ask the board to support a letter to Gail McSweeney to draw it out as the sense of the members of the Board of Selectmen, that she take her personal agenda someplace else and that she tender her resignation. And I would ask that in the form of a motion.
We have Arthur has made a motion as he has described. Do I have a second on Arthur's motion?
I second the motion for discussion.
Seconded by Matthew. Want to have questions, Matthew?
I just have a few comments to make. And first of all, as a man member, I agree with Arthur a few months ago. However, I would like to state for the record that if the two sides had come together without legal representation and try to work these things out between themselves, I think that would be for the best.
I think it would be wonderful, but the reality is that that's not going to happen.
My understanding of some of these legal bills is we had some issues with open meeting law violation complaints. And but Arthur is right, they all centered around the Board of Health. And they've continued, and we've had additional work done with our attorney. It isn't just one time. and those costs do add up. That is why we have a legal department, however, and the town does have to defend itself against complaints of open meeting laws. But then again, you go to the source of what causes all this, and I would have to agree that there does seem to be some personal issues involved here, and they don't have anything to do with taking care of the day-to-day business at the Board of Health. And I'm really hopeful that this has come to an end, but I cannot state so that I actually know that it's going to come to an end. I'm hoping that it's coming to an end. And I think we have answered with our legal expenditures questions that have been raised, and I'm hopeful that, you know, we're done with that. The chairman of the Board of Health has stated that if an item is not on the agenda, and she's right about this, it does not have to be taken up. And if it doesn't concern a resident of Pembroke, bringing Board of Health business to the forefront to be discussed and solved, then it's not going to be discussed. So I'm hopeful on that end. But as I stated, I have no inside information. I'm only hopeful.
Well, in a budget where we're scraping for pennies virtually every year, the potential to spend $20,000 is not out of the realm of possibility, and that represents a lot of money that could be spent elsewhere for public safety equipment in the school department, in the DPW. I mean, we've got places that we could spend that money, and it just seems to me to be ridiculous to try to ignore this and hope it'll go away, because it's very clear after 4 months, 5 months, that it's not going away, that it's just accelerating. And I think, you know, as the leaders of the community, we need to step forward and say enough is enough.
Anyone else have any comments they'd like to make? Jan?
Yeah, I do. This has been a tumultuous time that Mrs. McSweeney has brought upon the board herself and the town. And she had some questions in her own mind that needed to be answered. Some of them were valid. Some of them I thought were, as you phrased it, Arthur, an extra rhyme from something maybe previous employment. So we've been going through this time trying to answer her questions as they can, and it's cost money. To my knowledge, everything that I know of that she's asked has been answered. I'm not sure if it's all satisfactory to her, but I think the town has done the right thing in answering every one of her questions. So I'm hoping, as Lou is, that this is over, and we'll see where we go from here. Hopefully they just get down to business, roll up their sleeves, and do the business that she and the rest of the board were elected to do. And I'd like to afford her that opportunity. And the reason I say that is, a town or two away, about a year or so ago, there was a recall for a selectman. And I just think that when the voters have voted for you, unless you do something completely outlandish or illegal, that's the time to push someone out of office. I disagree with trying to push someone out of office unless they've gone to that extreme. I have to admit that the outlandish portion, the other portion of the envelope on that, in some people's minds, probably even beyond. But I'd like to afford her the opportunity to settle into her position and do the right thing.
I think you can only give so many chances.
Yeah, I can't disagree with that statement at all.
I would really like to agree with Atha on this, because this has been going on for a long time. And it's good that we brought this up and had some discussion about it, because this has not just happened since this person was elected and put into this position. This attorney's fees and legal fees were going on for quite a while she was working here. And she didn't like the answers that she received from the then police chief, the district attorney, attorneys for the town. I don't particularly think that it's going to end either. I think that it's probably going to continue, but there has to be parameters set by the chairman of the board that says that either she can bring items up or she cannot bring items up. It's up to the chairperson to recognize to talk about a particular subject or something that somebody wants to bring up. You just can't go out of these tonight if I wanted to talk about some particular thing. You just can't do that unless it's on the agenda. So I also would really like to think that this is over. And maybe if we could put a time limit on it, that if this is to continue for the next month, then I would be willing to sign what Arthur wants to sign. But I don't really think that that's going to make a difference to her anyway. But I would like to give her the opportunity that even if we send a letter from the board as a group saying that we're not happy with the way that things are going in this particular office, and either straighten it out and get it straightened out now, or then we're going to make recommendations and give them a certain amount of time to straighten it out and take care of it. I don't think there's been any parameters set that way to say that we're very unhappy. I have no problem sending a letter saying that we're unhappy with the way things are going, and it's not good for the town to be fighting the way that they are in the office there. Let them all know that we're at the point that we want to try to do something about it. And I don't know how that would be addressed in a letter, but it's a warning. I mean, everybody's entitled to a warning, so I wouldn't have a problem signing a letter that indicated that this was a warning letter, and if it continues after 30 days, then we'll try to take whatever action we can to have her removed.
I can compromise down to that. I mean, Dan has tried, approaching her at a meeting, and, I give him an A for effort, and, it didn't prove to go anywhere in terms of bearing great fruit, but we need to address it. I mean, it's just, it's ridiculous.
But if I may, I have no issue was sending a letter of explaining how unhappy we are that the way the board is operated, the way she is operated with the board. The one thing that I would like to push back against is any talk of what we'll do in the future. And the reason, not just for this case, because if we are unsatisfied with an elected member of a board, and even if this one is some people see it as egregious, even with this member, this board of selectmen will be seen by other boards as that we're ready to go down a slippery slope of threatening any board member of any board in town, planning board, assessors, DPW, you name it. So that's something we have to be careful of. Even though this is of one specific instance, and it's, you could say that the thought is well-founded, but the perception can be from other boards and committees, it can be seen as a threat. As an overstep of power by the Board of Selectmen, you can see that perception, can't you? Or see other people perceiving it that way?
Well, I think we're addressing a hostile work environment, and I think that's part of our job.
See now, there's a point that you can help validate a letter of reprimand. So I would support a letter of reprimand or acknowledgement that this board sees that the Board of Health is running dysfunctionally because of one member, and we want them to straighten her act up, particularly. I don't have an issue with that. I just want to stop short of what will happen next. That's what I. That's the compromise I would like to see, if it's possible. And I might not have the votes on that end, but that's what I would like to see.
Like I said earlier, I just think that it's precedent for the board to write letters of warning or whatever you may say, to write letters that are unhappy with somebody's conduct, the way that it's taken place. We give that right to every town employee. We call them in for a hearing and talk to them and advise them about what rules and regulations that they are under or what they should be doing. Unfortunately, I don't know what rules and regulations she falls under other than that she's voted in by the townspeople. I don't know if there's rules and regulations for the Board of Health. And if there isn't, then maybe there should be. And if they do violate that, then at least a warning could be imposed, and if the action continues, then whatever we need to do to follow up on it.
Could I have a suggestion that Arthur worked with the town administrator for a week and bring a drafted letter to us for approval?
It says what? You're creating a hostile work environment and we're not supportive of it?
Well, as Bill mentioned, he's not sure of the way they operate and what laws that they operate under. And we want to make sure that the letter is as strong as it can be, but within the bounds of our jurisdiction.
Yeah, I mean, clearly we don't have authority over another elected board in terms of who serves as their members, but I don't think we have to sit still and support somebody who is creating a disturbance at virtually every meeting, and it's cost us now, we're over $6,000 in legal expenses and police detail fees. I mean, it's crazy, and we can use that money in other places. And
I want to stop it too.
Anyone else have any comments? We have a motion on the floor by Arthur and seconded by Matthew.
Well, there's a, as I hear it, there's a substitute motion from Dan to have Mr. Thorne and I address a letter for the board's approval. And I would go along with that if the board sees fit to vote it that way, that we need to nip this and address it immediately. So I think that's a solution that works for everybody.
So is this a substitute motion, Arthur, or do you want to move forward
Dan.
With your original motion?
I agree with that, certainly.
Okay, so we'll substitute that in.
So we have a substituted motion eliminating the first one that Arthur made Do we have a second on this new motion?
Second.
Seconded by Bill. Any other questions or additions? Hearing none. All those in favor of the substitute motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Hearing none. I rule it unanimous. Thank you. Now we have a 7:30 appointment from Sealand Corporation. They want to talk to the board about truck routes on Birch Street. Would you come up to the podium, please, and tell us who you are?
Kevin Sealand, President of Sealand Corp.
Thank you. And this gentleman?
Yeah, Owen Kelly from Parkland Circle Builders.
Okay. Now, Mr. Sealand, what is it you want to ask us?
Well, we'd like permission to access or use town property as a haul road out behind the ball fields and Bridge Street. All gravel from Fire's property across to the Couplewood Circle project that Owen represents. They hired me as a contractor. I know Owen's met with Ed out there on the net today. And we'd like permission to do that as we walk today.
Just so the board will know, today we had a walkthrough. We had the chief of police, the director of the DPW, the board of health agent.
Never bring that thing in.
We had a gentleman from the town of Duxbury, a planner from Duxbury.
Paul Ragna?
Yes. And if I missed anybody, I was there myself, so. We have the opportunity to, I'll address the board with this if I may. I had the opportunity with those other folks that I mentioned to walk this property and saw the extent of the project that we're talking about, how vast it is. First time I had walked that property. But the reason why we were there was to discuss how we were going to transport fill that is required for that site. Conservation has also been involved, I will mention. The town owns some property, which is just on the other side of the Birch Street playground, heading toward Duxbury on Birch Street. So we can create a road entering from Birch Street just before the playground, about 50 yards away. And the trucks can access that and run parallel to a ball field that they are fenced in, and then access the Matthias property to get their load of fill. Turn around with the load, drive back out the same route, get to Birch Street on the town's property, the road that'll be there. Take a right on Birch, and it's about a half a mile from there to the property where this development, this 40B development, is being built. And there's another way of doing it. If you leave the Matthias property on Valley Street, we have deemed that you trucks cannot turn left to access Birch. They would have to extend down Valley Street to Route 53, take a right, and take a right on Birch and go in that way, and that's about a 6 mile road. Now the purpose of this is really not to make it easier on you, Mr. Sealand, because it's a shorter route, but we have to look at how the neighbors are going to be impacted. And if we use the route that I described earlier, using town-owned property, we are going to drastically reduce the number of people's homes that these trucks will be going by. So that's the way I'm looking at it. Apparently, there's no major issues that I'm aware of. Conservation, as I mentioned, is involved. We had the police chief, the DPW, director was there. I've also been told that the conservation agent has been involved and has approved this as well. It might have even been Bob Clark's suggestion that we use this property. So I would be convinced that that's the best way to go, having the opportunity of being there. Now, the other board members didn't have that opportunity, but they have maps. And Ed, did you have any questions that you wanted to raise?
No, I think these gentlemen are scheduled to appear before the Conservation Commission next Monday.
Yep,
Monday. Right.
Yep. Okay. And the chief did mention he thought we should do some trimming where the trucks are pulling out onto a perch. Right. Kind of went into detail with me.
Yeah. Chief Wall has made suggestions like that. And as I said, he was there and he walked the site. And he's talking about signage, and he was looking at the visibility as you exit that town-owned property on Birch Street, because Birch Street is a busy street. It's a cut-through street to Route 53, as we all know.
Dean Fullman commented he thought that Birch Street would hold up better. You know, obviously there's much less truck traffic on the other streets, particularly Valley.
Right.
That surface is in the greatest situation. So we thought that was an improvement, you know, because we wouldn't access Valley at all. We would go just that small half mile section of Birch, wouldn't involve Valley Street at all.
Right. Now there's going to be quite an extensive amount of vehicle traffic for your project.
Correct.
Because of the amount of fill that is necessary.
Correct.
So there will be a lot of truck traffic. Do you have, I forgot to ask you this today, do you have a projected date as to when you would like to start this operation?
It'd be about 30 to 45 days. And that's a major tree cutter schedule for the next couple of 3 weeks.
Okay.
So sure.
Anybody have questions?
I just have one here. I'm looking at the plan that has a blue line. It shows all of the roadway traffic, and the red line is what you're looking for permission to be driving through the wooded area that's going to make a road through there.
Well, there's actually a road there now. There's two roads either side of the playground. There's one right adjacent to the playground that accesses the playground and parking lot behind the playground.
Yep.
We wouldn't use that road. There's another road east of that runs up, so I didn't even know it was there.
Bob and Ed brought it to our attention.
Okay. Right. So we looked at that, and that'd be the way to go, because it keeps all the trucks away from the playground, away from that parking lot that serves the playground.
So does all of this run off of Birch Street? So it's not even on Birch Street? It's all in the woods?
It's all on Birch Street.
So the only access you're doing is cutting across Birch Street?
No. They're coming out onto Birch Street.
Yeah.
But if you look at the playground, there, the access, if you're looking at the playground from the street, the way to get into the playground, the parking lot, is to the left of it. These guys are talking about a road that is to the east of that. So if you're looking at the playground from the road, it would be to the right. And so they'll actually come straight down from the cell tower through that, past the ball field that's in the rear of the playground, as we all know. And actually literally come out onto Birch Street at a 90 degree angle, pretty much so.
Almost across from Cross Creek.
Yep.
Then we take a right down Birch Street. We go by, I mentioned in a cover letter how many homes would actually go by Birch Street. And then about a half a mile, maybe not quite.
Oh, so you'll be on Birch Street for a half a mile?
Yep, and then we turn the left into the new project.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah.
This just doesn't signify that. The red line that's on here shows that you're in the woods, not out.
Yeah, well, I didn't mean to do that.
Parallel
to Birch,
I
didn't want to cover the road up.
I know where that other road is. Used to when you have a cruise all the time.
Right.
That other road goes all the way through.
It does.
Yeah. So it's
in pretty good shape too.
The road.
Dirt road.
So you'd be coming out almost by Chapel Street.
Yep. Between Chapel and Cross Creek.
Yeah.
We're going to have a construction sign.
Is that what we're putting up?
Yes.
Redwood Circle?
Right. So we have construction signs that we're putting up anyway for the site. So we'll just extend it by the same code down the street further to cover that entrance with a couple of trucks entering signs and things like that, which we went over with the police chief.
I wouldn't have a problem with lines. How many vehicles, how many trucks a figure a day are you going to be coming out of?
I mentioned a lot of quite a few.
You're going to need a detail down there, so?
That's, I don't think so. I mean, that's something the board can decide on.
Yeah, I asked Chief Walton.
We'll leave it up to the chief if we.
Because we could review that with the chief too. After the signage goes up, plan to send him a message, just have him go out and review it and make sure everything is good.
I have no problem with one that I told the police chief that whether he sees fit to have a traffic officer down there for, if he says it doesn't need one, then that's kind of it.
Anyone else comments?
I have a question.
Yes.
So we're talking about trimming some trees and bringing a lot of trucks in and out of the wooded area. Do you have any intention to offset the carbon emissions and natural degradation that will take place because of this?
Well, I mean, the project requires X number of cubic yards of fill. Normally, that fill will be coming from offset sources several miles away, Carver, Middleborough. So we're going to cut emissions by at least half. Taking the four going down the 6 miles all out of the same pit. So, I mean, I think that speaks to that very well.
So you have no intention of going above and beyond just cutting of the route?
Cutting of the route?
Cutting up like the route. You're cutting down the time and you're going miles your trucks and the cost that.
Right. Much less miles means much less carbon.
Right, right, that's true. But you're also talking about trimming our forest, which would cause natural degradation. The Pembroke fueling plans offset.
No, we didn't.
Matthew, I think that'll be a discussion that Mr. Clark and the Conservation Commission can have, because they can require, you know, any restoration of anything that they disturb on the property, because it is conservation property. So I would think that Mr. Clark and the Conservation Commission would address that when they were done with the project, the restoration of any vegetation that was disturbed, I think, could be addressed.
Yeah, I think that's a good point. I mean, there should be some stipulations that we return it to, pre-construction levels. Right. That's more than fair.
That's a great point. Thank you.
Dan?
What is your intention for wheel wash stations? Keep the mud and dirt off of the roadways?
Both coming and going? Well, what we're going to do is the typical construction aprons. We're going to do the first 50 to 75 feet crushed stone coming off the road, so that should take care of the wheel wash.
It's already specified on our site, but we'll do the same thing at the entrance to town planning.
And I think we should also say that, you know, we can have a sweeper to clean up. That's more than fair. I anticipate that we'll have to sweep it maybe as much as twice a day. You know? So I think we have to monitor that and see how that goes. But obviously, in dry weather, it's less of a problem. But as we get into fall, it comes back to get wetter, and it's a good question.
And we're going to be working right across this, essentially right across the street. So the same parameters that apply there, we can apply to this entrance to make sure that First Street is maintained properly.
Will you need a legal easement to, or a temporary easement to be able to drive up and down this road, or merely an agreement?
That'll strictly up to Conservation Commission.
Okay, so if there was any talk of remediation or compensation, it would be through the Conservation?
Right, and I've already talked to Koppelman and Page about that. So, sure and ever, it's been made aware of the project.
Is there, refresh my memory, do you need a special permit to take more than 500 yards off the site?
It's already permitted. Class is already permitted to take this material. The permit's in place. We'd just be trying to substitute, you know, the permitted roads, the normal roads, the 6-mile route with a much shorter route that affects less residents.
Okay.
I see Mr. Clark at the back of the room. Bob, would you like to make any comments?
I didn't hear enough of it yet to make. I made my comments to Ed about some things that I've seen that could be a problem. I think it could be done, but there's a lot of areas that need to be ironed out long before the first truck can run. Okay. We do have some complications there. We have buried utilities in that area from the cell tower, and we have a playground we have to watch on this. There is a way to do it, but it's going to take a lot of cooperation between these two gentlemen, you and conservation and all that to get it done. And it's got to be the best way because our roads can't stand all the pounding they'll be getting otherwise. And the phone lines are on and off of them, so all the people that be calling, they're going to worry about the trucks going up and down the road.
What about the people that live on Burr Street? Have they been advised of this project at all? The one that would be affected by this?
They would have been advised, obviously, when we were going through the permitting to the DBA. But they got notices that there will be street signs going up before we start any construction for the next 2 weeks or so. There will be street signs up.
Yeah, what we don't want is a whole neighborhood of Burr Street people coming here wondering why that there wasn't a public hearing.
Yeah.
To indicate that why you allow all these trucks to come on and ask you. So,
that's a point, but if you look close at the plan, either way, those people, you know, even if we don't use the town land to cut across, we'll still be going by those same houses.
Okay, all right, good point.
And so we're just going to be going by less of them.
Yeah. But I think it's a good idea to publicize the project and the route of the trucks especially. There's nothing to hide. We just need, I think, to get out there and inform the public through our local paper.
Okay.
Would be a good way to do that.
Yeah.
And we can publish whatever information that the town has decided to grant you for this particular project.
Okay.
And the other thing I'd just like to mention, because I know the board would be very concerned, are very concerned about this many trucks going by the Birch Street playground.
Mm-hmm.
But in either case of the two choices we have, they're going to go by that playground. So it isn't what we're being considered to change the route is going to go by the playground. And if we went another way, we're not going to go by the playground. That's not even an issue. So I just wanted to make that clear.
Yeah. And depending, who would be the best person to talk about what to publish in that?
I thought I'd work it out with the secretary.
Good. We'll
think so.
Perfect.
Yeah. Now, did I understand correctly that you are not going to appear before this board to get approval for hauling that dirt on the route that you're asking for? Because when we have other projects, since I've been on the board, we set certain rules that the trucking company has to follow.
Right.
The days of the week, the hours.
Right.
The times they start. So did I understand that you said in the permitting process this is not going to happen for this project?
Well, there are rules in the permit for the comprehensive permit from the DBA about work hours, truck hours, and things like
okay.
that. So those are dedicated in there, along with truck routes are specified there. So
well, the truck routes in the Matthias's permit.
Right. So there are truck routes on both that we have to comply with.
Okay. So
and,
maybe
in hours and time.
Maybe this board just gets to see what those are.
Sure.
Yeah. Okay, we'll get those.
That would be good for the public to see also.
Great.
Do we have any other questions from the board? I'm sorry, Alpha.
Yeah, has anybody looked at the potential conflict between the truck traffic and the school bus traffic?
No, but we can look into that.
Yeah, I would think you've got the playground and you've got bus traffic.
When we met out there, Bob actually again came up with using this alternative road so we stay away from the playground altogether. But we could look into when the school bus goes through there. Is that what you guys say?
Yeah, I mean, it goes through, you know, in the morning for pickup and the afternoon for drop-off. And, you know, you're talking about running 10 to 15 loads per hour. That's a lot of traffic.
Yeah.
What we can do is look and physically take a look at when the buses travels for the day, over a couple of days. See if we can kind of bend our schedule a little bit with the trucking. You know, there must be a certain couple hours in the morning, but it's most busy, obviously. In the afternoon stretch is probably more spread out than I would imagine, I would assume. But we'll take a look at it.
We're pretty lucky.
And plus, I wonder where the buses turn around at the town line. I don't know what they do.
We're pretty lucky with the manager on all the buses is right here in Pembroke, right near the Country Corner store.
Okay.
So you could probably just stop by the bus lot right there and talk to the manager, and she could give you everything you need.
Mrs. Cruda, is there now?
Elaine
Cruda.
Or is she still there?
Yeah, Elaine Cruda.
Okay.
That would give you all the bus routes, how many buses go down, and how many go there.
Oh, thanks.
We can tweak that schedule a little bit, so you don't get kind of...
Should you have, you know how many buses go through?
Oh.
Yeah, that's what we'll ask all that, because it should be easy enough to just say, at this time, we'll pause, they can go through, and we'll cut the crowd.
Hey, any other issues?
That'll be the advantage of the half mile as opposed to five. It'll be less complex.
Right.
And you'd be willing to restore the wooded area back to its...
Yeah. Right now, it's actually a very good road on the way, so we don't have to take down trees. We don't have to take down, I think there's like one tree in the back on the conservation property, which we'll discuss with them. But mainly it's just stabilizing the entrance, making sure we take care of any kind of dirt and things like that. Besides that, it's just sight lines. So trimming back a couple of the bushes to see down either way. It's very clear, which is why it's worked out nicely.
These are 10-wheelers?
Yes. 10 little triads.
Okay, we need a motion here on a decision on this alternate trucking.
Make a motion as approved by all the boards, the police chief.
I'd like to see the school bus data before I'm prepared to vote.
Yeah, that type of information would be what we would need to know if you were coming before this board.
Sure.
For hauling drip.
Mm-hmm.
So we still need to see it. So,
well, you could table it till next week because they're meeting with conservation. Yeah. Nothing's going to happen until after they meet with conservation.
Sure. We put it off for 1 week and then make the decision next week.
Yeah, that way we'll have the conservation input.
Okay.
Yeah, makes sense.
Well, I think, am I correct then that the only issue for us is a bus route, making sure that we know what it is and how we can accommodate that before we would vote?
Yeah.
And the restoration of the woodlands afterwards.
Okay.
Seems to make a lot of good sense. Even using the back roads instead of coming across the menu road,
does.
Okay, so we'll table a final decision until next Monday evening when we have the bus route schedule and a plan and the restoration of the woodlands.
Okay.
right?
Thank you.
Okay. So.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks for coming out today.
Any old business that anyone would
I know, you were busy on that.
To mention? No, I didn't mention that. We're going to cover that in the town administrator's report.
Oh, okay.
Nick was on here to be here too. So we are going to have that. Under old business, I wanted to bring up to the board that, as we're all aware, we have a new policy on signing warrants, where we have one selectman responsible for signing it. The last 2 weeks, I signed 1 week, Arthur signed another.
You've got details of policy.
Do we, as a board, want to decide on how we're going to handle this? Do we want one selectman every week to take turns? Do we want one selectman to be given that responsibility? Or how do you want to do it?
What a suggestion. We generally know ahead of time when the board will not meet. So prior to that date, the board can vote, just like we did the very last time.
Well, next Monday, now tonight we have warrants to sign. Who's going to sign them tonight? I guess
all of us.
That's my question.
All of us.
Yeah. Okay.
All of them.
All right. So it's only on weeks that we're not going to meet?
Correct.
Okay, well, okay, I'm all set. That takes care of old business. So we'll move on to the minutes of August 22nd. Do I have a motion?
Move to accept the minutes of August 22nd, 2016 as written.
Motion by Arthur. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Dan. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Voted not present.
Bill, not present, so the vote is 4-0, 1 abstaining. Excellent. That's great, Bill. So we're the town administrator's report.
Last Thursday, we've had a telephone conference with Sun Edison, town council, Nick, myself, and basically we were getting an update on a solar project at the Cap landfill. They're proceeding. They have financial company. Onyx is taking over the project. Sun Edison will continue with TRC, which is the engineering firm. They're out there the last couple of days with Mike Valenti and Bob Clark, in delineating the wetlands so they know exactly where to put the solar panels. They are moving forward on getting the project 60% funded by the end of December by actually 48, and the plan is to be fully operational by May the 8th. They are moving forward. They will be making a presentation in front of the Board of Selectmen and the Planning Board in a couple of weeks. And then they'll also be required to have a public hearing with the Planning Board, a formal public hearing as opposed to a presentation with the Planning Board a second time. So basically, they are moving ahead. They worked on the interconnection agreement with the Department of Public Utilities and National Grid, and so looking forward to them giving me a call as to when they're going to be putting on a presentation in front of the Selectmen for the public. While we're talking about the ponds, Bill, Representative Cutler was in my office on Friday to talk about a site visit on Monpozit Pond in Halifax, which would be held September the 24th at 10 a.m. at the Monpozit Boat Ramp, which is on Route 58, to talk about the situation in that particular pond as well. So to segue into Bill's.
Jeff Cutler was also put on most recently in the meeting that we had and a visit to a lot of the different ponds and so away for one pond to Furnace Pond, Holden Pond.
So this meeting Saturday with Tom Coulter at 10 o'clock on the Monpozit. Good place to have breakfast.
Unfortunately, I can't make that meeting.
Okay.
I have a prior commitment to Saturday, but if you want me to talk about the last meeting that we had, I'd be more than
happy. Yes, I'd be very happy. Go ahead, Bill.
I've attended two meetings. Recently on the diversion of water from Furnace Pond, and which also includes Olden Pond, because Olden Pond typically runs into Furnace Pond every day. Unfortunately, because of the droughts that we have now, there's not very much water in either one of the ponds, and the brook that goes through it has a very small trickle that goes through there. At the last meeting of the Central Plymouth County Water Commissioners meeting, as you know, the prior meeting, I had brought up a lot of concerns with the commissioners about the Pembroke ponds and some of the things that needed to get fixed. More like one of the screens that they use on the diversion pipe is broken, and the juvenile fish are able to get into that broken screen and go to Silver Lake. That was one of the issues. There's another issue on the dam itself, on how we operate the gate that's on there and that needs repair. And we've addressed both of those issues with Brockton, and so far they haven't helped out. Some of the guys took money out of their own pocket and bought a net and put it across so that we wouldn't lose juvenile fish into Silver Lake last year. And it looks like we're going to have to do the same thing again this year. We did save the net, and we will put it up as soon as juvenile fish are able to get from Olden Pond into Furnace Pond. But I brought up my concerns at that last meeting very strongly with the commissioners. They understand where Pembroke stands on that. They do have a grant. We've requested that we have an engineer look into the datum of Furnace Pond specifically so that we know where the water level is supposed to be and how much water that they can take above or beyond that particular point. It was brought up about the migration of the fish. Of the fish coming up in the spring, that they have a right to divert water, and also in the fall, in the middle of the migration period, they have a right to divert water there. The current fisheries board has done really great work in cleaning the streams and getting all everything repaired and fixed, so that this past year we had a real big abundance. This past spring, I would say, we had a real big abundance of fish coming up, which is the highest in a long, long time. It was 238,000 that they counted electronically before the counter was removed. And a week or so after that, there was thousands of fish that was in the stream that still wanted to come up. And that's all you could see was fins in the water down there with the fish coming up. So there was probably another, I would have to estimate 50 or 60,000 fish that were still coming up in the front of the pond. So we raised the gate down there in June to save water so that we would have enough water for the springtime, for the fall time, for the juvenile fish to go down. Unfortunately, Brockton saw that there was so much water there that they took it. This is something that they have a right to do according to the law. And unfortunately, the only way that that's going to be changed is that we need to do something through the legislature. Unfortunately, nobody wants to tackle that. And, they don't think that it's a viable option that we go through the legislation and try to get that particular thing changed. It just doesn't make sense that they made this law 2 years ago, and now it's affecting the migration of the fish, which is a big thing for Pembroke. That's why they settled in Pembroke years ago. So it's we've been trying to stay on it quite a bit. We've got up a good working relationship with Brockton, and when we see that there's a problem with the fish down there, then they're very good about shutting the migration off. But unfortunately, they still have a right to do that. They still have a right to take the water. And as the water gets, you know, less and less in different places, much more are they going to take. I think we would have been in good shape if they had left the water in Furnace Pond. At least we would have enough water to get the fish down this year. There is another option. I called the Division of Marine Fisheries last week, and I talked to Brad Chase, who's the head of this whole area. And he told me, unfortunately, what we're going to have to do is be patient and wait. And hopefully between now and Thanksgiving time that we get enough water that we can divert the fish downstream. So, it's too bad that we have to wait that long to get them down there, but we're looking for some other ideas that what can we do, because we feel that it's a problem. So it's, I think we're on top of it. We're fighting City Hall or whatever, but we're trying to do the best we can. There's also other issues that Abington Rockland really hasn't even been looked at yet. They're taking water out of Big Sandy day after day, and that water is down so low that we think the water from Furnace Pond is actually going through the aquifer underneath the ground and going over there and supplying them. So, it's something that really has to be looked at. I know Josh Cutler and Danny DiMacito is they've been to a lot of meetings that I've been to about this. They're up on what's going on and what's happening. So hopefully we can do something in the future to either change the legislation or get some type of a letter from Brockton and Abington Rockland that migration of the fish is an important thing for Pembroke. And I know people have to think about it, but if you have another avenue or source to get it from, which Brockton does, then they should be using that. And they did open up their distillation plant, and they have been taking so many millions of gallons a day out of that. So by the squeaky wheel, we've done a lot of hauling to Brockton, and they're finally using that plant, which they haven't been using it for quite a few years here, so it is being looked into. So it's an important thing that we keep our eye on, and what we don't want to do is see it get into bad despair down there. I know Furnace Pond now is probably down 2.5-3 feet. I have a picture I'll show you of a blue heron that's way out in the water, and he's only up to his knees, you know, looking for fish, so it's, normally, you know, he wouldn't even be able to walk along the shore, and it is part of the shoreline, not only Kermit Pond and Holden Pond, but Big Sandy, Little Sandy, these other ponds around, and I think they all kind of feed into each other, and if they keep taking it, it's just not going to be there, because what's going to happen in the future? Our well's going to go dry, you know, the wells that we have in Pembroke, so something to keep an eye on, and I'll try to do my best to what we can get it down.
Phil, can I ask you a question? You said that legislation may be the answer, but it doesn't seem like we've got a good chance to get any. Is that what you think?
Yeah, I've had some conversations with people, and they said to change legislation on this is probably going to be a very, very hard thing to do. And the Brockton will probably fight it tooth and nail, if that's it. You have the money, they have to fight it, because they're getting the water for free. So whatever money they have, they would probably fight it tooth and nail. So it would be a big battle for us to try to change that. So will we have the money to do that? Probably not.
It's been said that they make all the NWRA. Is that
violent? Well, I think what a lot of the people, especially Kingston and Halifax and Pembroke, would like to see them do is to go to the NWRA. But there again, it's going to cost them money to do that. They're going to have to start paying for their water. They won't be getting it free on Silver Lake. So they have looked into, you know, putting pipelines in and all that stuff and getting it up there, but I just don't know where that would be at this point. Probably where I would say I'm finding that, unfortunately. So. But it just seems a shame that we're starting to bring the fish back, and that doesn't mean it's not going to continue, but it's disheartening to see that you can't let them go on their normal course of movement, because September is their month that they start to migrate down. And unfortunately, there's not enough water to allow them to do that. It's not only just in Furnace Pond, but in the brooks that are in the back of Furnace Pond that go down through Center Street, Mill Street, Mountain Avenue, and down that way, there's they just don't feel that there's enough water to get them there. They were thinking, well, what if we dug a ditch from Oldham Pond to Furnace Pond to allow the fish to go through there, or put in a pipe, or did something, piped them in, or whatever, and people were trying to come up with ideas, and that's not the only problem where there isn't any water. There isn't any water in the streams. So when they go out back into the streams and you're walking in the streams, there's not very much water in the streams either. So we need a lot of rain, and hopefully the best in the next couple months.
On the same vein, did you have a call from a gentleman that would come under and ask the selectmen?
Yes, I did.
I know you had a conversation. Did you want to let us know about that?
Yes, a resident of Furnace Colony called, and he indicated that he was very concerned about the pond being so low, and he was also concerned about the migration of the fish. So I did talk to him for some time on the phone last week, and told him what we were doing, how we were doing it. He offered his services, because he said that he was retired, and that whatever we needed to help, he'd be more than glad to help. So he was satisfied with the discussion that I had with him, and kind of educated him a little bit about what's going on and what we're doing.
Good.
So he was happy with that.
Very good. Anyone else have anything under Ask the Selectmen?
I have a comment about the hearing.
Oh, yes, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
There's some provision in one of the laws, I think it's the 1800s one, but it might be the 1960s one, that allows Brockman to take the water from Pembroke. And it says that there has to be a certain amount of water that goes over in the dam down the river to support the river. Right now it's dry. And they, I'm assuming they're preparing to take water in the next few weeks.
Well, they can't take it until October. October 1st, they're allowed to take it, but it has to be up above that datum. If they know where the datum is, unfortunately, we don't. That's what I want Pembroke to know, is where our pond level is. Put something in there from an engineer to indicate what the level is, and have that recording device go right to the town hall or to someplace, the town barn, or somewhere that would be adequate that we would be able to see that and find out what's going on. And also, the same token, that maybe we could have something in there that we would know when they were diverting.
Yeah.
Because we don't have that. If you ask them for it, they'd be more than glad to give it to you and tell you when they're diverting and how much water they're diverting. But you're right, Arthur, this 300,000 gallons a day is supposed to be able to go over that dam. And for nature reasons, to keep the streams and the brooks open and all of that, and that hasn't been done. There's no water to
do. I don't think that's been fault for years and years.
Yeah. So it's when there is enough water, they can take anything that they want under a certain time. But my point is that there should be a different level there because of the problems that we've had with migration. And if we're saving water, why are we saving it? I think we could just lower the gate and say, let them go.
Yeah.
But we've been very good at saving it and watching that over there, because that's right in Arthur's backyard anyway, and he looks at it almost every day. So we know what the level is over there, and it's unfortunate that we put in boards and all kinds of other stuff to save the water, and then Brockton says, oh well, there's all kinds of water here, so to open up the thing and away goes this little lake. And I don't begrudge them from having any water, but we have to take care of what we have to take care of here in Pembroke first, and then whatever is extra, they should get. I don't have a problem with that. But you're right, there should be 300,000 gallons a day going over that dam. It's not.
And the dates that they have on their schedule, when they're allowed to take water and not take water based on the herring, they're way off, because there's herring going through there most of the year. Yet they can pump, is it May, November to May?
They can October 1st, right to May.
And then there's going to be thousands and thousands of fish coming down in November even.
Right. We had fish going down last year, as you know, the first week in January. We still have fish going down. So we had in March, when we were down there repairing the dam, there was juvenile fish going down and there was adult fish coming up.
A very important fish.
Thanks, under new business, anyone have any new business?
Mr. Chairman, actually, yes. I had something under Ask the Selectmen.
Oh, I'm sorry, Matthew. Go ahead.
A resident reached out to me to ask our status about the Cranland Airport situation. I know the town administrator just someone gave us a report from the Hanson town administrator. I was wondering if we made any progress or made any more inquiries since then.
Mr. Chairman, we haven't heard anything other than the fact that there were no complaints about the airport to town officials in Hanson. That's the latest I heard from them.
So they have not changed the flight path from that airport?
No.
And that was
not according to the executive assistant of the selectman's office in Hanson.
And that particular weekend with the heavy plane traffic was because of a special event they were holding there?
That's correct.
So I guess we had to go more of information.
Then once a month, I think it's third Sunday of the month or something like that, they have a breakfast over there in the summertime. I think that probably would be down much.
Yeah, it was.
They have a lot of planes that go in there in the morning. But that's only once a month. As far as I know, I don't think we can divert anything unless you do it through the FAA.
Thank you.
Any new business from anyone? I have one thing here. We have voted to put together a letter stating this board's opposition to legalizing marijuana use, which will be question four on the ballot. We voted to do that, and Sabrina has put together a draft letter that was in your packet. And I'd like to get some comments on whether we're going to go with this draft as is, if anyone has any corrections or additions that they would like to make to the letter. And I would like to be in a position next week to be able to sign a corrected letter if we need to.
I wanted you to review it first. I'm sorry, it wasn't in every packet.
Oh, okay.
I wanted you to be able to make your changes.
Oh, I'm sorry. I
no,
thought it was
apologize.
In the backup. All right. So, for next week's meeting...
Did you approve the draft?
Did I? Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. So, I'd like to get a copy that the board could sign.
Okay.
Can we do that for,
absolutely,
for next week?
Sure.
Thank you.
Okay. Speaking of letters...
Yes, Dan.
I asked the town administrator to work on the letter to the Board of Assessors. Have you had any movement on that? Send from a ask the Selectmen.
I'm the follower here.
At our last meeting, this board voted that you, myself, and the town council would review and draft a letter to the Board of Assessors. I handed you my written draft copy, and you were going to look at it with a couple of pages and get back to us so that this board could have a revised draft.
My apologies, but I don't recollect that. So maybe you could share that with me when we end the meeting.
That's fine. We'll look at it over the course of this next week.
Mm-hmm.
We'll bring it next week.
Yeah. Good. Okay. Is there any other business to come before this board? Yes, Bill, thank you. We have a gentleman from the Board of Health. Do you have any issues for us?
No, I'm just going to see you guys in person.
Okay.
Making sure that you're running appropriately.
We want to recognize your presence. If you had an issue you wanted to bring up.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
How are we doing?
How are we doing?
Yeah, you said that you wanted to make sure that we were doing everything appropriately. How are we doing?
Four of the five of you passed the audition.
Okay, yeah, we have a need for executive session. Mr. Fawn?
Yes, sir.
Can we have a motion to go into executive session?
I would move that we enter executive session in preparation for negotiations with non-union personnel or to conduct collective bargaining sessions to contract negotiations with non-union personnel and a town meeting Article 15 and number 3 to discuss the strategy with respect to collective bargaining or litigation if an open meeting may have a detrimental effect on the bargaining or litigating position of the public body and the chair so declares.
Police
and that applies to police and fire. Thanks, Dan.
Second.
Motion by Arthur, second by Dan. This will be a voice vote. Dan?
Yes.
Pat?
Yes.
Arthur?
Yes.
And I vote yes. declare it, we will be going into executive session. There will be not any reason to resume or to take any public votes at the conclusion of executive session. So I would thank you all for watching, and the next meeting of this board will be Monday, September 19th at 7 p.m. Thank you and good night.